at the meetings, architects, designers, but certainly the public's invited and the public will have an opportunity to participate in those roundtable discussions. So they happen here tomorrow. There's an open studio every day from 7 in the morning till 9 at night. It won't always be as active throughout that 14 hours, but there'll be somebody here. There'll be many of the same maps and opportunities for people to provide individual personal input if you either can't make a meeting where there's a group effort or you feel like you still want to contribute your own personal opinion to what we're trying to do, which is build a vision plan, a shared vision that'll help shape the future growth of the North End. And Brian's going to show you some of the maps and images that are on the wall in his presentation to define the North End. But essentially, it's from the sort of foot of Dennett Street and Maplewood. We have a current commercial district over there on Maplewood and Dennett. And it includes that portion of the North End across the North Mill Pond into this area, which everybody sees commonly as the North End, which includes Nobles Island, does not include any of the waterfront on the other side of Market Street. Now, some people have already asked me why. I think the easy answer is the salt piles and the piles of metal require and demand their own charrette process. They're complicated pieces of property from a land use and economic and from an environmental standpoint. We had a limited budget and a limited amount of time and a core focus on the North End. So if the city decides they want to do a vision plan and look at the code, the zoning code again, for that area of Market Street, that's a separate project. Same applies really with the rail corridor that Pam Ann owns from Maplewood all the way out to Kate Street and the Frank Jones Center. It really demands, given the amount of real estates that is there and the complexities involved, its own charrette process to figure out whether what's there and the way we've zoned it is the way we want to move forward. So this is phase one of a two-phase charrette. We're doing 4 days here in the North End, and at the end of February, early March, we haven't pinned down the date yet, we're going to be doing a four-day charrette on the Islington Street corridor that'll run all the way from the Route 1 bypass all the way back into 51 Islington Street, Bridge Street, the Discover Portsmouth area, both sides of the street, the McDonough Street neighborhood, between the railroad tracks and Islington Street will be included in that charrette. So we'll be doing very much the same set of exercises. TPUDC, Town Planning and Urban Town Planning.
Design.
Urban Collaborative. Design Collaborative, who did our charrette last year for the downtown. Brian Wright, Bill Wright, his father, Emily Wright, his wife. Becky, I don't know your last name.
Wright.
Timmons, what?
That's my cousin.
Wright. Yeah. They're going to be coming back to do the Islington Street charrette in late February, early March. So, a few quick announcements on the space here. It will be open from 7 to 9, I already said that. If you have to use the bathroom's locked and you'll have to grab one of these key fobs off the wall. There's one for the men's and the women's bathroom, so make sure you grab that or you won't get in. Parking, we have validation permits for the parking lot across the street, where you go in and get a card and you have to pay. If you bring your card in here, we'll swap the card out with one of ours and you won't have to pay to get your car out. So you can park in that lot for free. You can park, which is on this property, you can park on the street, or you can park over in that lot at 299 Bond Street across the road. I believe 3S Art Space, which is right through the far window and it's under construction, I think it's Chris here from 3S Art Space. They had mentioned some interest in having folks be able to go over there and tour the facility. So I guess until I get that confirmation from Chris, I'm not sure when that's going to happen. But they'd like to show people what they're doing because it's a big part of how the North End is changing, what they're going to be doing with that building. A lot of people showed up on Saturday. The newspaper said about 50 people showed up for a site walk from PS21. There were a number of people in here today that didn't make that site walk on Saturday. I would encourage you, because it takes about 15 or 20 minutes, to do a walk of maybe less the Maplewood Dennett Street side, which most people are familiar with from driving, but Vaughan Street and Green Street are not high volume areas for most citizens of Portsmouth. And certainly when you go over behind Gary's Beverage and get over near the Rock Street Park and up on Autumn Street and Hill Street. Most people haven't been there. I would encourage you to get out there and walk the neighborhood. It doesn't take long, and it'll certainly help our collective efforts to visualize what works, what we like, what we don't like, and most importantly, where we want to go when we look at the future development potential of the entire North End. So what else have I got here? We're here to put a vision plan together. It's a little bit different than downtown, where we basically had a built environment where the focus was on preservation. This is a focus on new development and how that new development is going to fit in with the quality and the character of the buildings and spaces that people want to see in Portsmouth and the North End, and look at these very diverse pieces of the North End, from Dennett and Maplewood to this section to Gary's Beverage, Autumn, Hill, and all the way over to Rock Street. They're very different contexts and demand, I think, very different zoning code to reflect what the interests, goals, and objectives are of the community. So this is intended to be a very public process. The output of this four-day charrette is to get a sort of common ground or general agreement on a vision plan, not necessarily unanimous consensus. That's hard to get, but get general agreement on the kinds of buildings and spaces that we want to see in this acre, in this area, which is about 80 acres. So enjoy yourself. I think spread the word. We've got a pretty full room here tonight, but there's a lot more people that I'm sure we need to plug into this process over the next 4 days. So spread the word. Missing a meeting doesn't mean you're out of the loop. You can come here and do these exercises at any point. And these people are highly skilled facilitators to be able to get anybody up to speed to make sure their input and their ideas are recorded here and brought forward into this common plan towards the end of the 4 days. So I'll turn it over to Brian Wright, and we're going to be here, I think, for about an hour and a half, right, Brian?
I think
or
so.
Or 2 hours, whatever it takes. We're open till 9.
Awesome.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you need this?
I think I'm okay. Okay. I think he says he has me on audio here. So I'll try to talk loud. So I'm Brian Wright. I'm principal of Town Planning and Urban Design Collaborative. And I'm glad to be back. Nick mentioned that we worked on the plan and the code for downtown. And so when we were here, all those years ago now, was it like a year ago? Yeah, a year ago, everybody was saying, what about the North End? What about the North End? Why is that not in the study area? And so the answer was, okay, you know, we'll come back and do some more. And then also, what about Islington Street? And I said, okay, so we'll come back and do some more. How many people participated in the downtown process? Excellent. Okay, some new people. That's great. And some people who came back. That's really good. So for those who don't know me yet, what I try to do is go through the presentations pretty quickly and get to question and answers and comments and just whatever, and we just have a chat. So we work all over the country, and you know, we're fortunate enough to work here before, and so we learned a lot of great lessons and learned some of what was important to you guys, at least in the context of downtown. And we got a hint of some of the things that everybody was thinking about or concerned about in the North End. And so what I did realize was there's a lot of passion about what's going on in the North End, and so I'm ready for it. I've been bracing myself all week. But the good news is that this is the time to really sit down together as a community and start to figure out, you know, what is everybody looking for? And so what we're going to do is, you know, we don't have a stake in it. That's one of the benefits of being from away. You know, so our process is really open. And the idea is that we're all going to sit down through this process together throughout the week and really come up with some ideas. And we have blank pieces of paper. I mean, literally somebody came in this afternoon and they're asking, you know, what does the MRO zoning mean? And it's like, I don't know. I can't remember. It's been a year. It's, you know, we worked in all these other places. And so we really have no preconceived notions about what's supposed to be. That said, there are some things that are already in the works that we'll talk about in a minute, and so we'll go through that process as well. And some of that will be frustrating to you guys, I'm sure, from what I've heard so far, and others of it will just be exciting opportunities. So without further ado, I'm going to move forward here. So being from away and getting to work in many different cities around the country, we sometimes walk into places where we say, wow, we've got to spend a week here? I don't know if we can help these people. This is really a hot mess. You know, I don't know what to do. So when we come to other places like this, we say, oh my God, get out the cameras so we can take pictures, so we can show those other guys what the heck they want things to look like, you know, in their city. And so what we try to do, and I shared this with you guys in the downtown process, but for me, just looking at the assets about, you know, sort of the postcard views that you guys have around here, the working waterfront, this, you know, this salt pile, you know, for me, I was excited when we came into town the first time and I saw the scrap metal and salt. And I thought, wow, this is a real place. You know, this is not just about the beauty and the history. It's like things are happening here. And that's, you know, unusual these days. In a lot of places, it's all just been jettisoned. So that was kind of cool. You know, these streetscapes that you guys have, the pedestrian life, the activity, the vitality in the streets, these little moments that you discover something as you turn the corner, those kind of things get people really excited. You know, anomalies like the Wailing Wall. You know, we researched that and figured out that, you know, you guys were one of just a few of these around the world, and that's pretty cool. I don't know how everybody feels about the whale, but, you know, as an outsider, it's a charming. And then, you know, just the interest in sustainability and authenticity and the great restaurants you guys have here. I mean, it's like every night we can go to a different great place to eat. And, you know, that's a real luxury because a lot of places don't have that. We're struggling in some towns we work in to find, you know, a couple of places that we go to over and over during the week that we're there. So that's really nice. And then just overall, when we first came a year and a half ago to do the interview, to do the first project, I told the planning department that I was obsessed with your city. I collect historic maps and bird's eye views, and you know, this is something that hangs on the wall for me. This is, you know, when you see a place like this, it's just so amazing. And so you guys have the whole thing going for you, not just the snapshots, but all of the pieces that come together are really an asset to make this community special. So we did the zoning ordinance. If you haven't looked at it, you should. It's a really amazing read. Zoning ordinances are, but for zoning ordinances, this one actually is pretty nice. There's pictures and there's graphics and it's nice to look at. And so that was adopted and everybody's looking forward to some submissions coming through under that. And so the idea is that it's a character-based code and it's focusing on, rather than thinking about uses, typical zoning separates one use from the next. Here we're thinking about what is the character of this place, what's the essence of it, and how do we put that into a zoning ordinance, which tends to, at least for the past 50 years or so, has been devoid of character. It's really just you can do this, you can't do that, and mostly you can't do that and keep this away from that, and you get what you get in the end. And so what we're focusing on is on character here. So what the code does is it protects what you love the most. So we work together to determine what is it we love the most. Downtown, it was really easy. We love pretty much all of this, and so we just make sure we don't mess that up. That was, you know, that was the challenge there. And so as we work, you know, into other areas where there's more new things, oftentimes we find in every city we go to that the newer it is, the less loved it is. It's just, you know, part of the situation we find ourselves in these days. Part of it is because sometimes new is scary and different, and we don't like it. And sometimes new is just worse. You know, it's just worse than what was. And it's hard. I always comment on the proposals that you guys fight and fight and fight against. Architecturally, in other places, you put them in any other city, and it's a masterpiece. But here, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, how do you even live up to the rest of it? So the architects and designers and developers have a huge challenge on their hands, but it's because this place is so great and it makes you guys care about it and it makes it hard for them. So we have to figure out, you know, how do we take what you love and infuse that into new things so that, you know, in the end we're wanting to ensure that any redevelopment that happens is going to enhance what you've already determined that you love. And so, you know, there's some interesting discussions to be had around that topic as we go through this process. And then what we want to do is maintain and expand the uniqueness that makes this place special. That's really hard for a code. Zoning codes, like sort of regular, you know, sort of, it's really easy when you start looking at the numbers to homogenize. And so we have to work hard for you guys to make sure that the code doesn't do that. And so as long as we keep it as sort of one of our top three things that we're thinking about, in the forefront of our minds, then we ought to be okay. And you guys will, through this process, sort of make sure you're our litmus test on this. You're going to make sure that we don't start homogenizing. And again, as we move out of downtown, some of these concerns aren't as paramount as others, because when you're moving in these newer areas, oftentimes there aren't things that are so unique or that people are worried about. So these are still important things, and the code will help us with all of those. So the two study areas, I know in the back it's really hard to see. So here's the north end. These are all the boundaries that Nick was describing. Here's the second study area with Islington Street. Let me zoom in. That helps a little bit, but not that much. So Market Street, and then here we have Route 1 here, salt piles and metal piles. I think we are here in this building. And so this is where we'll be focusing while we're here this week. So this is the existing zoning. And what you can see here is, in this small area, quite a multitude of different colors, which in some ways, when you walk out there, you might be surprised. It doesn't look all that different, one piece of property from the next. And that's one of the things that, when you start thinking about character and character-based approach rather than a use-based approach, you start to not need as many colors. Because if the character is in keeping, you can start to see, in your historic downtown, those buildings that are next to each other have been hundreds of uses over the years. One building changes, and now it's a dry cleaner's, and then, the next day it's going to be a restaurant, and then it's going to be a clothing store, and then, whoa, somebody lives down there now, and then it changes, on and on and on. Things change, but because the character of these different areas in the downtown are compatible, you don't have to worry about separating them one from the next. And so here we're going to be looking at and studying the existing zoning classifications within this 80 acres that Nick mentioned to start to see, what of those, can be consolidated and really focusing on the character. The other map here is the one that will be of particular interest to most of you in the room. And I know you can't see it up here, but it's on the wall. There's one here, there's one back there, and there's one on that wall. So when we finish, you can get up and take a close look at it. But this is what I'm calling the property status map. And this is the map that is color-coded and shows you which piece of property has a plan that is approved, which one has a plan that's in the process, and which pieces of property are actually sites where we have an opportunity to do something and decide together, what can happen in the future. So take a close look at that, but, it sort of pops out on this map, but the pink areas here are really the areas where there are opportunities to vision for the future, okay? And so we'll work together on those, and we'll look at it more later. Now, as Nick mentioned, this is going to be a little bit different than in the downtown, because here we're actually going to be drawing plans. We're actually going to say, here's a piece of property. We don't own it. We don't control it. Some of them we do. Some of them the city, they're city pieces of property or whatever. But we're actually going to say, this is an opportunity site, and we're going to draw some ideas based on the input we've heard here about what it could be to start to think about, rather than just having development happen as it will. You actually can say, landowner, developer, here's some inspiration for you. We all worked on this together. If you head this way, we're probably going to be excited about it. That said, as we start drawing on these pieces of property, we don't have all of the information that you would typically have when you start a development application. So we're not going to have, detailed surveys, or we're not going to have all of that, those sorts of things to make sure that it's perfect. And so likely whatever happens on it in the future will, can take inspiration from what we all work on together, and then it will revise it based on the site realities. But the zoning, the thing that's great about doing the planning is it starts to allow us something tangible to talk with you guys about. So you say, I don't know if I really understand the whole character thing. And then I say, okay, well, no problem. This area over here where there's a redevelopment opportunity, we've drawn a plan here, and here's a rendering of what that could look like. How do you feel about that? And you can say, wow, I really like that. And I say, well, good, because the character of this is going to be in the code. And so it's a way that we can talk through things as well as help, sort of guide as best we can the future of what happens on the property. So when you start to see us drawing plans, don't be surprised or concerned. And so here's what that looks like. And this was in Yarmouth, Maine. So a couple of months ago, we were over there. So here's sort of their main road that comes through. Here's their train tracks. There's a depot there. There's a river here. All of this is their historic village. So very, very sensitive. You know, they're much less urban than you guys, but they're very concerned about it, just like you guys were in the downtown. And so we took liberties on property, and we looked for opportunities where there was underutilized land, which would be like somebody where they'd built a parking lot out in front of a business, right in the middle of the historic stuff where the buildings are all up to the street, typically. We looked for, you know, all sorts of opportunities to do things. And so what you'll see is it transformed here. So all of these black buildings are proposed new buildings with the parking hidden in the rear. We did a transit-oriented development, so a train station could actually, you know, start to have passenger service, and people could live above shops adjacent to the rail and all of that. So we drew on all of this property that, you know, we didn't control. But the pink things are existing, mostly historic, and we left them in place and we kind of worked around them. So we'll be doing those kind of exercises this week. So then we also did this. So there's this Dunkin' Donuts, and everybody in the town hated the Dunkin' Donuts. They all ate there secretly, but they hated the Dunkin' Donuts. Because up and down the street is this fantastic historic little main street, so charming. But here they pushed it back, you know, they built a parking lot out front, there's a Dunkin's and a dry cleaner's, and we don't like it. Well, what they didn't like was the character. It didn't fit with everything else. And so we said, okay, we know you hate Dunkin', but what if we did it like this? Now this is Dunkin' Donuts, and here's the dry cleaner's, and everybody cheered and clapped, you know? And so these are the kinds of things we'll be working with you guys on this week. Here's that train station I was mentioning. The Dunkin' Donuts is just off the picture here. Train station, this is sort of a little pitiful town common they have. You don't even notice it when you drive by. And so we said, you know what, let's make this into something special. And we did this. So now here's the train station, here's a proper town common, here's a transit-oriented development where people live above shops and the sort of little artisan community here. You go across the tracks. All of this, and now they've got a proper center. And so we're going to be thinking about these types of things as we look at opportunities in the area. So we start with, from the zoning side of things, though, we start with looking at the existing zoning, as I mentioned. And, you know, we look at not just our study area, but we look outside to see what's, you know, kind of what's the context that we're in, because we want to make sure that we're responding to that as well. And then we think about the idea of the character-based approach. And the way the character-based works is that you look at a continuum from the most rural to the most urban based on the context in which you're found. So here, the first character district would be a natural zone, which would be, you know, untouched. You think about like state parks or preserves or things like that, where you really don't have any human settlement going on. Not sure, we may not have any of that right here in the study area. You never know. The next zone, as you're sort of working your way from nature into civilization, is the rural zone, which would be where you'd start to see agriculture. So that would come in, may not be in the zone. I'm just giving you guys the full picture so we can start to talk about which zones you guys have. Then we get into the third character district, which was sort of a suburban, not suburban, suburban. And so this is sort of like the most loved neighborhoods you have around the city. The historic ones are the larger house on a larger lot, set back farther from the street, but still addressing the street in a really nice way. The fourth zone is where you start to get some convenience retail, some commercial, people living above shops, but still some detached single family. And actually for you guys in the downtown, we did a special fourth character district, and I'll show you that in a minute. And then as you get into the fifth, it's primarily mixed use and commercial with people living above, not really any detached so much. And then in some places we go where it's really urban, there's a sixth district. But what we heard in the downtown was there, you know, wasn't necessarily much interest in going that big. And so we wanted to respect that. And so I didn't even, you know, show anything. So here is what the coffee table book of, this is nature. That's the character district one. This is what agriculture, the rural zone looks like. Character district two. This is suburban. Character district three. This is character district four. And five. And so the thing that's interesting about it is, depending on where we are, so this is pretty urban feeling. This is character district five, but in another place, this would be their fifth character district as well. And so each of these character districts is even not only which ones you have in your town or your city, but we calibrate each of them as well. And so we go through a process that we call synoptic surveying. And so we went out in the downtown when we were here last time. We literally walked every street, and we became as expert as you can in 1 week on the historic character here. But the way we do it really quickly is we go out there with measuring wheels, and we measure sidewalks and street widths and setbacks and lot widths and all of those things that are the DNA of these areas of character that you guys most love. And so we've documented all of that, and those became, when you look at and you study the downtown code, you see the numbers, the setbacks and all the different metrics that are in there, those came from our synoptic surveys. So it's really, you know, you say, well, why is that, you know, setback what it is? We say, oh, well, because, you know, over here we looked at that and this was what it, you know, told us. And so here's what it looks like in your existing downtown code. So this is the fourth character district, and we did this sort of L, which was you have this unusual circumstance where it's sort of larger buildings on wider lots, but they're pulled up to the street in a very interesting and unique way. You don't see that in a lot of places, and so we made a special character district for that in the downtown. This is the regular character district 4, so you can start to see here's some row houses, here's a live work, somebody living above, and down the street there's detached single family, on street parking, nice sidewalks, and then here's character district 5. And so you see, you know, the character, who knows what's happening in these buildings? I don't know. You know, we probably aren't going to have some sort of a chemical factory, probably, you know. So we actually do look at uses. There's within some parameters, you know, use becomes important. But as long as you get the character right, for the most part, you're in the clear. So, and then we did a regulating plan. And so this is what we'll do here. So we won't just be drawing these sort of illustrative vision plans. We'll also then determine where on the ground each of these different character districts is found in the north end. So here's your downtown regulating plan. And each of these colors, these, you know, 1, 2, 3 colors is coded to each of the character districts that we identified. So very simple, very elegant way to deal with the zoning. And then these are actual pages from your zoning ordinance. And so we start with sort of a general description, the artist rendering, some examples, some photographs to say, you know, when you're building in this area, do things like this. We want more of this as we like this in these districts. This is what we heard from the community. And then we do sort of a technical drawing, and you start to see these letters on here, and these letters keyed down here to things like setbacks and building heights and all of that. So it works together, but you sort of get more technical for those who are really technically oriented. And then we start talking about things like civic space. Instead of just saying we want open space associated with new development, we say civic spaces, and civic spaces have names. They're defined as squares and plazas and pocket parks and playgrounds and greenways. And here we actually added one for you guys called a pedestrian alley, like the one I showed you that was so nice and unique. And so these are very specific, and each one of these is coded to which character district it's appropriate to be found in. We focus a lot of attention on how the building addresses the street. Okay, we call that the frontage type. And so there are several frontage types. I'm not going to show you all of them, but here's one you might have heard of, the porch. And if you think about it, the porch is a way that you address the street. It sort of mediates between the public street and the private house. And you sit on there and you have sort of a rail and you feel a little bit private, but you're still in public. And so that's how you address the street there. And this is what a porch looks like. Here's a step. This is actually a new one. We made this because what we found is that you guys don't always have stoops, which look like this. You actually sometimes have this thing that's a step where there's no actual landing at the top. You just kind of step out. Sometimes it's one step here. There were two. And so we actually, again, even the frontage types, we think we know them all. And we come to a place like this and we say, oh, here's a new one. And we add it so that it's always going to be about this place and be calibrated to what you've got going on here. And then a shop front, pretty straightforward. You have some amazing examples of shop fronts around. We also focus on building types, what building types are appropriate in different character districts. And so here's what a house looks like here. Duplex, and this is great because in a lot of places we talk about duplexes and people freak out in other parts of the country because all they have are these sort of suburban versions of duplexes that are sort of scattered around a parking lot. And then we can show them what you guys do here. And they say, oh, okay, I actually like duplexes. That's really nice. And row houses and live work units. Small commercial buildings, a apartments, and this is another one that we can show people and say, look, I know you're afraid of apartment complexes, sort of these suburban apartment models that people always see. And then we show them how apartments are done in places like this, and they say, well, I don't feel too bad about that. That actually feels great. I wish we had those. And then large commercial buildings. And there are other types as well. And so here's how it kind of all lays out. When you start looking at a streetscape, these are sort of some of the key elements that we focus on in a character-based approach. So again, the building type. So here you see a live-work next to a duplex. So those work out. And then you talk about the glazing percentages, that's how much of the facade is covered by windows, because the amount of permeability into the building is important for you as a pedestrian to feel like you're not sort of walking along a blank wall. Makes it feel more comfortable. The frontage type, so shop fronts and stoops. The setback, in some cases, they're zero. In other cases here, the thing I like about this one's pretty well pulled right up to the street, and this one's set back just like 2 feet, maybe a foot and a half, I'm not sure. And that's the thing, you know, when we have numbers in a character-based approach, you don't say the setback is this. You say the setback is between this and this, in a sort of a reasonable range that we found during the synoptic surveys. So it allows for that sort of authentic in and out that you see happen as a place naturally evolves, and you know, most of the time before zoning. And so it's one way we can allow for some of that to happen. And then focusing on the number of stories, which we know is a huge deal here, right? So we learned our lessons about stories. And so we're good with stories. And so kind of to put it all together, all the different parts and pieces, to sum it up in a nutshell, sort of you have the private frontage, and that's sort of from the back of the sidewalk to the front of the building. And then you have the public frontage, which is from the back of the sidewalk to the back of the sidewalk across the street, or right-of-way to right-of-way. And so here in the private frontage, that's the responsibility typically of the owner of the property, the developer, whatever. And so the code is influencing that. But we also have things like street sections to show you how to build a street, especially if you have to do a new street or if you're going to change a street, here's how you do it. And that happens within the public frontage. And all of that comes together and you get amazing places like this. So it was really great. And again, I was so lucky to come work here because now we have this great photo library. So I show this picture all across the country when I say, okay, it's like this. And then you get this. Well, you wish you could get this, but we know some people who have it. But you get the idea. It all works together. So Nick did a great introduction. So I'm just going to tell you that we're doing a charrette this week, if you didn't know. And it's happening mostly here. What that's going to look like is this is us right now. Presentations will be one of, you know, the few presentations we're going to have this week, because this is a lot of talking for me. I want to hear from you guys. If you'll see tomorrow, when you come in here, you'll see this. This used to be an abandoned storefront before our team showed up. And so it's not just me and my family and all my cousins, Nick. I've got other people with different last names that'll be here. They just haven't arrived yet. Strangely enough, it just occurred to me that two of them, we've got W's here with us and the Wrights, and then we've got Zanetta and Zonarich coming. So we're at the end of the alphabet for a lot. So we're going to be setting our studio up here when we're done with these tables. We're actually going to be working in this space. So when you need to find us, this is where you come. And we have some times that are set on the schedule officially. We'll probably be here later. You'll probably drive by or walk by and see the lights on in here and see us. If you can somehow get our attention, we can come outside and talk to you if it's after hours. And we had to do that. We're working in Burlington, Vermont. We're right on Church Street in Burlington. College students everywhere, 2 a.m., coming back from the bar. They want to knock on the window. Hey! And they were really strict about, you can't let anybody in after this time. So we had to go out there. It was like February, January. We're freezing cold, snowing, and we're talking about planning with drunk college students. So we're here for you. So, and then after we finish this, this evening, we're going to break out around the tables here and do a hands-on map exercise that I'll tell you about in just a second. And then throughout Tuesday, we're going to have meetings with specific topics that Nick mentioned. And we're going to sit around a smaller table. And so it's a much more intimate setting. And you can, you know, if you don't like talking in front of a crowd or whatever, it's a good time to come and chat with us. This is the thing, if you can see in the back, we're going to do, this is called listening. And a lot of times we have to remind people of this, everybody tends to come to these things and they want to say something, you know? And so what we want is for everybody to say say it, please. But we also want to hear, I have lots of listening, because we're going to listen, and it works the best when you guys listen to each other as well. And so we know that a lot of times there's a split decision on different topics. You know, people are, I'm heavily in favor of really tall buildings. Oh no, I want really short buildings, you know, and so there's that, you know, those kind of things going on in certain cities. And so we'll do lots of that. You'll also, you know, because we're in here, you'll see the design team will be drawing and working, and we can hear what's happening. They can hear what's happening at the meetings that I'll be sitting at with you guys. And so they can respond real time. And so you'll say, oh, the one thing you absolutely cannot do in the North End is dot, dot, dot. And then you'll hear erasers. So it's great. Real time works really well. That means you don't get too far down the wrong path before somebody pulls you back in. And then we'll have an interim pinup. So we'll start to show some of the ideas and share with you guys what we've been hearing, what we've been thinking based on what we've heard, and you know, sort of halfway through to make sure we're heading in the right direction again. And then on the last night, we'll do a closing presentation where we'll, you know, show you what we've done based on all your feedback. And then we'll take questions and answers again. Even though it's called the closing presentation, it's not a ceremony. For me it is, because I like to, you know, see what you guys think. But it's it really is just the beginning of the longer discussion. It's the end of this part of the process, and then we start talking more. So what we're going to do is, for like 10 minutes, we're going to do Q&A, and then we're going to break out and do our table exercise. And then after that, they usually generate some new ideas and thoughts. And then we're going to do, I'm just going to sit here as long as anybody wants to keep asking questions. But anybody at that point, you know, when we get to the official bewitching hour, whatever it is on the schedule, you're welcome to leave. You can leave before if you have to. But you're welcome to leave, and don't be embarrassed to stand up and leave. So when we get to the map exercises, though, I always forget this, the instructions. There are instructions on the table, okay? So it's not a big deal, but I just want to say it, because sometimes people are like, oh, it's a list of instructions. What we're going to do is we're going to have green dots, blue dots, and red dots, okay? Green is good, right? Red is not as good. And blue are opportunity sites, okay? And so you're going to put these dots on the maps where you think things are good, where you think things aren't good, where you like to see opportunities for redevelopment. And, you know, we have the map, the boundary drawn on here, and if, you know, you want to say there's a green dot outside the boundary, you can put it out there too. I hope there'll be some green dots on the inside of the boundary. But, you know, you can put them outside to say, look at that for inspiration if you want. Then there's also markers, and you're going to write any ideas you have, things that, you know, aren't necessarily associated with a dot. You're going to draw. You're going to say, you know what, I'd like to see a connection from here to here. It's really important for, you know, X, Y, Z. It's something that you can draw with the marker, and they're Crayolas, so you can tap into your inner child, and you can just go crazy. The table that makes the most marks on their map will win a prize, okay? And then also the markers are great, because sometimes when you put a dot and we don't know what the dot is for exactly, sometimes it's clear because we've heard about it, or everybody's put the dot in the same place. But if you'll just make a note what the dot's sort of pointing at or whatever, that'd be hugely helpful as well. And then when we're done with that, we're going to do that for like, you know, 20 minutes or so, 25 minutes, then each table will elect a spokesperson for their table, and another person for the table will hold the map. And they'll come and they're going to present. You guys are going to present to each other and to us. And we're going to be taking notes throughout all of this process. So it's fun. It's really fun. But I always forget to tell the instructions, and it's a free-for-all. So Emily's raising her hand. What did I forget, Emily? Oh, yeah. So there's a number on your name tag. Right. That's the table number. Don't go yet. When it's time. When I tell you. Yeah. So each table has a number. So you're going to go to that table number. Okay. So let's do Q&A for like 10 minutes. So questions about the process, questions about what in the world we're doing, questions about character-based code, or just things, your visions. So like, hey, I can't wait. I got to tell you this. Make sure we do this. Anything goes.
And we got to use the mic.
Yes, we got to use the mic.
Who's got the first question?
Thank you. My question is, one of the big aspects of the portion of the North End that's the smaller one that's over toward Deer and Bridge Street, that corner there, appears very likely that that will be the site of a future parking garage. I'm wondering how much through this process can we influence what that parking garage looks like, maybe how it's structured, or is it too far along to be able to influence it through our process? Do you have any insight on that?
I have a little. Only a little, because we try to come with blank pieces of paper and blank minds about these things. But I have heard of such things. I also learned last time that I was here that you mentioned the word garage at your own peril. So I'll I'll do it, though. I'll be bold. Okay. So where were you talking about? Were you talking about in this area?
Yes.
Okay, yes. So I've heard that there's a possibility of parking going on there, parking garage. And I forgot to tell my team members to turn their phones off. Sorry.
$5.
Good job, Dad. Okay, so yes. So it's my understanding that it's a super preliminary discussion, and it's shown as a different color. What does that green color mean again, Nick? Conceptual design project. And so that means it's so early on. I think there's some thinking about it. There's some discussions about it. But I think that it's fair game. Just so you know, just to set the tone, when we think about parking in a character-based area, it's tends to be in the back. It's supposed to be in the back. And we have what we call lot layers, and you'll see that in the downtown code. And so what we want to do is make sure that anytime there's parking going on, that we've got what we call liner buildings, or lining it. So like your existing parking garage that's across the street from the hotel we stayed at last time, this is all garage. Here I am, you know. And so in an ideal world, you'd actually have habitable space, have people, you know, shops on the ground floor and people living above. For, you know, even if it's very thin, I mean, there are liner buildings that are like 20 feet deep, which you think, how in the world could somebody make that work? Well, clever designers and people who are willing to do that and live in that or work in that make it work. And so those are the kinds of things we'll be thinking about. And so, you know, as far as I know, it's something to draw on. So next question. Oh, come on. Okay, yes.
Hang on.
Oh, well, Mike, sorry. Come on, Nick. We need another mic.
Under character development, where you're looking at the style of the building and situated on the lot, how under the First Amendment can you handle things like adult bookstore, you know, adult stores where you pay to go in, I call them porn shops, casinos, things like that? They could be in a beautiful Victorian building and be horrible for the neighborhood.
So yeah, so what do you do about porn shops and casinos and adult bookstores and stuff? The short answer is you do what you do normally in zoning. And so I don't recall if you allow porn shops and casinos in downtown, but I don't think so, right? So we basically, you know, like I said, you still have uses, even though you're thinking about character. And so within that use table, it would say you can't do that stuff that you guys aren't excited about having. So same thing. Yes?
Speak loudly, it's not amplified. So say someone has a great idea to put something someplace, a park, a building, a particular way. How do other people find out about it and arrive at agree that it's a great idea?
Yeah, so one of the things is when you do a process like this and an idea starts in a forum like this, somehow it has a different gravity than if you're just sitting at your kitchen table and you're like, you know what, it would be a great idea if they had a park there, and I'm going to write a letter and say so. Here, we actually have the opportunity, you know, you could suggest it from your chair there, and then we can all hear it and we can all have thoughts about it and talk about it together. Now, what happens is, so a park is a great example. Many, many times we'll see people say, you know what, we need a park in this neighborhood and it should go right there on that piece of property. It will be awesome. Let's do it. And everyone says, yes, that will be great, a park, except for the property owner. And then you say, oh yeah, somebody does own that property. And then so we say, okay, that's great. Now we know, we have complete consensus. Everybody says it's a great idea. At that point then, you could have the discussion, are we willing to pay for that? Are we willing to somehow have control over that property to make it a park? Are we as citizens going to do a Kickstarter campaign and, you know, crowdfund this thing, and we're all going to put our pennies in and we're going to buy this piece of property to make it a park? Or you say, you know, you go and you talk to the city, and, you know, so you go through the normal process. So the thing that's great about visioning is that it allows for the possibility of something to be different than it could have been had it just been left to those who own the property exclusively, and they just did their own process sort of at their office, and then they said, here we are at the planning board, what do you think? Which is normal, you know, most cities, that's typically how it goes. And so here we have an opportunity. Now, the thing is, you have to take that opportunity with one caveat, that you can't get really, really frustrated if it doesn't happen just like we drew it, because we only have so much control. The good news is, though, that the character-based zoning means that even if they don't do just exactly what we drew and don't put, you know, a plaza right here on this corner and all of that, it still means what you're going to get is good urbanism, good walkable places, good, you know, all of that, all of those things that you guys are looking for. Now, that said, you guys are particularly sophisticated here, more so than a lot of communities. A lot of communities, they just say, could you please just put the buildings in the right place, for heaven's sakes? We'll just be happy with that. You guys actually say, and you better make sure that the architecture is spot on and amazing too. And so that's a whole nother thing. The character-based code only does so much. Your architectural standards and that you guys are going through a process of working on, that will sort of come into play, that next level of protection. But as far as the visioning and all of those kind of things go, it's a great process to have the potential to make a positive influence on development to be more like what you guys are imagining. Yes, microphone.
I'm still confused. The character-based zoning describes the exterior appearance of the buildings in perhaps little zones within the bigger character-based zoning map. Is that correct so far?
Sort of.
But it does not say, or does it, what you can do within that zone. Is that another overlay zone saying you cannot put a porn store, you cannot put a hotel, you cannot put this and that? Is that all part of the character-based zoning, or is that like an overlay over it?
No.
And I guess the follow-up question would be, the current zoning, zoning boards of appeal, historic district commission, all of that kind of stuff stays the same as it is now and has the same oversight over whatever is happening?
To the last question, yes. So the process is as it is, and Nick and Rick and everybody can speak to that better than I can. So this is a page from your zoning, okay? And so you turn like five more pages or some, I don't know how many pages. There's a table of uses, just like in your old regime. Same thing. It says in this zone, you know, in CD5, you can do mixed use. You can do, you know, office and whatever. You can't do porn shops. You can't do casinos. You can't do an insecticide factory. So it's the same system. Same system. That's, people ask that kind of question a lot because we focus on character. Use isn't that important. And then I say, within certain parameters, which is not very descriptive. And so then somebody always asks me that. So yes is the answer. You're still protected from all of the stuff. And you know, as we go through this process too, we'll work together to look at the use table, you know, as we did with the downtown code. You know, everybody looked at the use table and said, yeah, we think that should be a use in that district and that shouldn't be. So we'll go through all that together. Do you want to say any more about the process, Nick?
Well, I would just say with the downtown, the three main drivers in the zoning are the use table, the dimensional table, and the parking requirements. And in the downtown, the character-based district that we did it just over a year ago, that was adopted in April of this year, we didn't change the use profile at all for the downtown. We changed the districts and how they're designated, but the use table was not changed. The parking was not changed.
We only changed and focused on the dimensional requirements for where the buildings get situated, how tall the buildings are, how much of the land the buildings cover in terms of the floor area ratio and the size and volume. And we adopted a set of interim design guidelines to start to address through the HDC the architectural sort of stylistic components of those building volumes. That may or may not be the same for the North End. There certainly is the ability, as Brian said, to reevaluate the use table and make sure all the uses that are allowed in the North End and its current four or five zoning districts that are out there are appropriate for the properties that are there. And the same goes with parking. And certainly, in particular, I think the dimensional table will likely need some massaging, just like it did downtown, to continue to have the quality and character of the buildings that we have downtown and in these neighborhoods in the North End continue to be here and not all be non-conforming, which is the situation with a lot of them. So,
great.
The process is very similar with the HDC, the Zoning Board of Appeals. We're trying to minimize the need to go to the Board of Adjustment or the Zoning Board of Appeals because the zoning should be more commensurate with what we want, and if it is, the buildings will be more likely to be where we want them and not need to go to the Board of Adjustment or Zoning Board of Appeals to get relief, which is a high bar for a developer or a landowner to have to go to put a building where we want it to be as a community. So
yeah, so and one of the things that's interesting is when you come to a place, and this is the case in many places we go, and I can't remember if this was something you guys struggle with or not, but often, here's the scenario how it works. Somebody has a piece of property. They want to do something with that piece of property. They set forth to develop that piece of property. They make an application. Everybody assumes it's going to be awful and they're not going to like it. And so you go through this whole process of having to kind of like fight it out. You duke it out and you go through. And so the more times you can see it, the more times you can give input on it, because you don't know. You don't know. There's not a lot of certainty. The existing zoning doesn't necessarily protect you from the things you're worried about. Otherwise, you wouldn't be worried about it. And, you know, we were working over in San Marcos, Texas, a couple of weeks ago. There, it's amazing. They feel like it's a great relief, a great victory, because they've just decided that you can only amend the comprehensive plan every 6 months. Because the way that it worked before was every time somebody came in with an application to do something with a piece of property, it was not in keeping with the zoning. But to change it, they had to change the comprehensive plan. And so the way that they did a development there was you start your project by changing the comp plan, and then you change the zoning, and then you go do your development. And they nearly always got to change the comp plan for every single development they did. And in other places we go, we do comprehensive plans as well, and they're like, yes, we haven't changed our comp plan in the past 10 years, and the state's making us do it now, and so we have to be in compliance. And so the process is really important, but if you've got all of the elements in the zoning the way that you need it and want it to be, it makes it a lot simpler for everyone. It makes it where you don't have to keep coming and fighting for projects. It makes it where somebody who owns a piece of property can know what they can do with their piece of property, and that's what they can do. And so it really kind of, the idea is to help everybody simplify the process, but still having all of the checks and balances in HDC and all of those kind of things in place like they do in the downtown. That's the way that was set up there. And so, you know, we talked about the process, you know, as we were working on the character-based code for the downtown, and I'm sure we'll talk about it here as well. But in the end, it's about predictability for both sides, for everybody, for citizens and property owners. Yes, ma'am.
One sec.
Thanks. One of the maps on this wall, I think it's the 1877 one, is really indicates the scope of all of the buildings within that map, shows height, depth, mass. Yeah. And I think the city is missing that there's been talk about doing some sort of rendering, an architectural rendering, that would actually be on a table so that anybody coming into, say, City Hall or Planning Board can actually see the size, the scope, the mass. And I think that's really been missing. And I did hear a comment made by a Planning Board person. If he had realized how large a building was going to be, he wouldn't have voted for it. So I think that's missing in this community. I think when you look at what's happened over the past 7 or 8 years, that people shake their heads after the fact. And there has to be some way for the community to see what a building looks like in relation to 7 or 8
right.
or 10 blocks around it.
That's actually one of, again, you may take this for granted, but that's a really sophisticated thing that you just said, and it's not the first time I've heard it in this city. You won't believe it, but there is actually a 3D model that has been built. And so now it's set up. I don't know if this, I'm just like spilling the beans here or what, but so. So it, you can go online.
It's actually on the city's webpage.
Yeah, you can.
That's what I'm talking about. You sit at a table so someone can go to City Hall.
Oh, you mean a physical model?
I mean a physical
model. Oh.
That's been a lot of talk about.
I see.
Actual.
Okay.
So, you can go into City Hall and say, oh, this building is 45 feet high, and it stands next to a building that's 20 feet high.
Yeah. The model that they built, the 3D model, the computer model, anybody who has a computer can look at it.
Absolutely.
And you can spin it around, and you can be a pedestrian and see what it's remarkable.
So you can look at it even on your phone.
Wow.
And if you like this map, this is the model. And you can, anyone can look at this 3D model and gauge the size of the existing buildings and what a new building. And we're requiring now, it's hot off the press, to require developers to provide us electronic copies of their buildings as they move through the permitting process, not just when they're done, but at the beginning and all those iterations that go through the HDC, they're submitted to us electronically, they go into the software, and we're in the process now of being able, we're doing it at the next HDC meeting for the new buildings, we're posting a scene, a 3D scene, that you'll be able to see the proposed building within the context of the existing buildings that are around that site. So you're going to have the ability, you already have it now to see what's there if you go to the city's webpage and look at it, but we're going to have the ability within a week or two at the HDC to take new buildings as they're conceptualized by applicants, put them in the city's model, and everybody, including everyone in the room and everybody that's got an internet connection, will be able, and you can go to the library if you don't have one at home, and be able to visualize the scale, bulk, massing, height, of any of these proposed buildings before they're approved. So we have a more informed decision-making process across the board.
There are very few cities in the country that have this even available, much less require developers to submit it. It's remarkable.
And Brian, I would just suggest maybe when they're doing their mapping exercise, we'll pull up the website and we'll show you so you can see it tonight.
Yeah, that's cool. Nick, we got one over here.
All right.
Oh, you first. Yeah, you had your hand up for a while. And then up on the front here.
So speak up, Bob.
Brian, did you say there are 80 acres in the north end that are being redeveloped?
Did you say that, Nick? 80 acres? Nick, north end is 80 acres?
About 80 acres,
okay.
The entire area that we're studying.
The whole thing, including what's spoken for, what is built on already. Yep.
What portion does the city own of that 80 acres?
Well, I'm not sure who owns the Union Cemetery and the North Cemetery of that city, only because I'm too new here still to know that answer, and I should know it. But if you look at the maps on the side of the wall, or trying to pull it up, the green areas are the parks, the civic space. So you've got the two cemeteries, the North Cemetery and the Union. You've got the Rock Street Park. And then you've got that. That's essentially everything. And then the right-of-ways. And the right-of-ways probably within there represent at least 20% of the 80 acres. So the sidewalks, the turf belts, the roads. So probably a quarter of it is owned by, well, that's a round number, but it's probably not less than a quarter of the 80 acres is owned by the city, and most of that is the streets, sidewalks, and turf belts between the sidewalk and the street.
So it would be difficult to try to have a park in that area because it's owned, most of the property is owned by individuals.
Donate that land to the city as a property owner. One usually has to pay fair market value, and that can be a complicated process.
So the people that own the properties all around the North End, they naturally want to develop that property to the most extensive heights so that they can get the most out of it like they did on the Port Walk and places like that, which has been developed already. I think what most of the people here want to see are low buildings over in that area, and of interest for people to want to wander into there without just walking around gigantic buildings like the Port Walk that we have.
Okay.
Is that good?
So,
yeah. So just as a quick response to that, obviously the purpose of being here is to see if that thought is shared. Of having smaller buildings, smaller footprints, shorter buildings, more public space, civic space, improved civic space that's out there. Most of these sidewalks are pretty beat up in the north end. They're not brick, they don't have period lights, there aren't street trees. So there's a lot of nuance that comes with making that public realm better. And this process is about all of us talking amongst ourselves and with each other to come up with a vision that hopefully is implementable and that we can afford and can be achieved. But there's no but. If we look at the areas that are privately owned, that are, for example, next to the North Mill Pond, there are regulations, unlike downtown, there are environmental regulations for setbacks, both state and local, that are going to prevent somebody from building as big a building footprints as we have over on Hanover, Maplewood, the Port Walk project. So there are opportunities, both external, looking at wetland regulations and shoreline setbacks, as well as the dimensional requirements of our zoning. Downtown, you were able to have a 60-foot building in most of the downtown before we finished this last charrette and project. And we have a street and block-based building height map. And some areas are suitable for 60 feet. Some are only suitable for 35 feet. We will probably go through the same exercise here with the synoptic survey and the results of the charrette to determine the size, volume, and character of these buildings and where they're placed and whether there's any opportunity for public space to be created in areas like the North Mill Pond. So I think this is a great opportunity for, as the article in the paper today said, half this area is likely to be redeveloped in the next 20 to 25 years because the buildings are tired. And you can see them all out of this window, these windows. So they're going to be replaced. So what do we want to see, ideally, these buildings replaced with? And what do we want the spaces between, in front, and behind them to look like? So this is a good opportunity to set that stage for the next 20 years. So hopefully 20 years from now, it looks better than maybe what we've achieved in other areas or what we'll get if we sit on our hands and just wait.
Nick, are you good? Okay, back to you then.
And you probably want to get to exercise soon.
Really quickly, you mentioned the shoreline. Where does all this, does this at some point marry up with any work that's being done on the sea level, the work that's all being talked about for sea level rises?
Certainly, I think climate change and sea level rise has to be considered. Sorry. The question was, how much of this exercise should or does relate to the issue of sea level rise or climate change, sustainability. And I think it's important for all of us to be thinking about all of those issues, threats, concerns, when we look at the areas that are clearly vulnerable to sea level rise, especially along Rains and Vaughan Street. We need to be cognizant of that in the absence of regulations. I mean, it's not well developed yet when and how that's going to play out in respect to the building code or respect to the zoning code itself. So I think we need to take notice of it, but not be paralyzed by it at the same time.
So we'll take a couple more and then we'll get to the tables.
There's a large development that's been approved already, Harbor Corp, which is going to take up a huge amount of this particular area. I was on the walk last Saturday, and there was a lot of question about, can there be a public walkthrough? Could we expect that to be, could we ask for that to be done? Do we have any influence over that? Because we have no idea what that's going to look like or be like at this point.
Nick.
So just to be clear, the Harbor Corps project, which is the Whole Foods here on Deer Street on these parking lots that are on the other side of the tracks, that has not been approved by the city. It's currently in front of the Historic District Commission, and it's in front of the Planning Board for design review. So the right context in which to provide input on the design of that project is the HDC, the Historic District Commission. Come to the meetings. It's not at the finish line. And it's just starting at the Planning Board in respect. It's at the Technical Advisory Committee, which is an advisory committee to the Planning Board. So they haven't officially started their public review process of that project under site plan review. So there's a whole lot of ground still before us and before them in making that project a reality. But it is in the permitting process. And it needs input from citizens. But that's really not the focus of this forum. Those meetings are. And importantly, while you're on that subject, for anybody that doesn't already know, 111 Maplewood, which is the address of this building, the former Portsmouth Herald building, was also the name of the project on that lawn and parking lot that's to the north of this building. And that project has been approved and will likely be under construction next year. And if anybody hasn't seen the building design, it's a four-story building with ground floor retail and restaurant and upper floor, I think there's 75, give or take, apartments that are over that building and all the parking's in behind. There are images of that building down in the corner for anybody that's not familiar with it. Because we've got 233 Vaughn Street right out the window that's been under construction this year. And everybody can see that building, and it's mixed use, but it's there. It's tangible. So that building's been approved and under construction. 3S Art Space is going through its renovation and adaptive reuse of that building, and then you have 111 Maplewood, which will ultimately, I think, have a different address that will go on the parking lot and lawn to the north of this building. So it's important when you go over and do your mapping exercise, if people want to put a park over on the north side of this building, it's highly unlikely that's going to happen. So,
all right.
Last question, maybe.
Yeah.
Last question.
Yeah. And if you haven't gotten to ask your question now, don't forget we're going to do Q&A after the table exercise too. So don't fret.
I just want to add a follow up to the last comment. You know, I think if we talk about parks as green space, we're somewhat limiting our visions. If you think about passageways, right-of-ways, easements, alleys, many of the little spots in Portsmouth that we like, they're not always just public spaces. Sometimes they're private properties that, you know, negotiated to allow an open space in exchange for something else, to allow something to be put in a, you know, a line of sight or whatnot. So I think we have to be careful of falling into park or nothing. There's so many ranges in between. And the beauty of Portsmouth, I think, is that we have a lot of these in-between spaces. They're public and private. And I'd like us to take that creativity into this process that we're starting.
That's great. All right, so I've got a question for you guys to help me as I start to think about this and take this to your table too. So as an outsider, when I, you know, and we haven't even done the tour yet, so I haven't even gotten to go out and walk around. I mean, literally, this is the beginning. And so this may be a really stupid question. Tell me about what North End means to you guys. Because, from what I've seen so far, there's not so much of the historic stuff, but there's as much passion about it as if there were. What does it mean to you? And, you know, why do we... You know, as far as height goes, I mean, is it just we don't like height, and it's likely development will happen here. Therefore, we're going to focus on North End, or like, what are all the? Tell me your feelings about it, and probably a lot of this we can get into after the table. So I'm going to let you guys marinate on that at your tables. But I'm going to take one person who wants to jump in. Do you have something to say? No? Okay. Yes.
Rick, hang on.
Mine are the views, the views themselves that have been lost. We entered from Maplewood. We come off the bypass, so we come down Dennis Street, and we'd be able to see our beautiful city, the North Church. It doesn't exist anymore. It's gone. That's something that a lot of people think is a disaster. We had this concept back in the day that we were all open-minded. My father sat on the HCC for 14 years. We didn't have the bickering and the ridicule. We had people we thought knew a vision, and people brought things to the table, But this bickering of going on between residents and commercial property owners versus residents, you know, who's against who kind of a thing. It's very confusing. And then some of the views and the thoughts that we've had, I'm still pondering over the fact that our HCC, our planning board, our town, our reps have gone and fought to have a Vaughn Street and that old map that's up there connected Vaughn Street all the way through the Vaughn Street section, right up to the music hall. That's the way it was. And I thought that we had gone and fought for that for so many years. And now a developer comes along and puts one great big giant boot at the end and is going to close off that section, and people now are saying, you can go around it. I don't want to go around it. I remember from 12 years old being able to have visions and be able to see this kind of a thing, and it's being lost. And I think if we work together, we can somewhat salvage what little we have. The view's gone, but I want that street open. And it's Portsmouth, it's residents that have to be able to speak up to be able to see that vision all the way through. Compromise, we compromise with Harbor Corp. We give a little, we take a little. I don't think anybody's even opened that door and suggested that to them. They want a lot from the city. We have ordinances that are out there. I think it's up to all of us to make that vision come true. Thank you.
So as you guys are working on your mapping exercise, so think about if there are any views left, let me know, because from away, we don't know. So you got to let us know where those are. We'll probably see them when we go around. So we'll take one last one. You take one last one, then we'll do the tables, I promise. All right.
Thank you. Yeah. I just want to say that I own one of the jewels across the street from the big project that's going in at 111. And I am so excited about what's going on in the city. I think it is. I've been here my entire life. My husband and I were born here, raised here. We are so excited that we live here and very thankful that we live here. And I think the city's done overall a great job.
Thanks. All right, so what does green dot mean? Green dot means good. Red dot means not good. Blue dot is opportunity. You're gonna the most marks on the map wins. So everybody look at your name tag and see which table you go to. We'll do that for like 25 minutes, and then we'll come back.
We had the same notion of the pond walk that the other two groups did, but we also looked at maybe even trying to do something with the bridge to get boating access into North Mill Pond. We talked about the potential of a parking deck there, but also the Rock Street Garage, turning that into some kind of a greenway that connects back to the Rock Street Park and then down to Bridge. That came out of the Seacoast Workforce Housing Coalition, Charette, a couple years ago. We noticed that there's like neighborhood villages, there's sort of a village here, there's sort of a village here, getting connectivity, pedestrian connectivity back into the heart of the rest of the area. One of the things we didn't want to see were single buildings surrounded by parking, sort of like I don't want to pick on anybody, but the building that Wells Fargo is in, Nobles Island, there's a few buildings that are just a single building, they're not connected to anything else, they're not part of a streetscape. We talked about pedestrian connectivity from this area back to downtown, you know, the notion of Vaughn Street or perhaps up here, but we just decided it's really difficult with the railway, and if there's some way to have discussions with the railway about where there might be appropriate locations anywhere along there to get across somehow. And then last, pedestrian connectivity back to the Albacore. Once you start bringing people back in through here, it'd be nice to have a terminus at the far end.
Thank you.
Where are my notes?
Over here. I think I got them right set up.
Wait. You can go this way.
I have to look at my notes.
I get confused at North.
Okay, so we had a lot of the same thoughts, we really liked, right here we put, our number one was that we actually talked about a walkway either under the Whole Foods or through the Whole Foods or over the train track for here for Vaughn Street, right? One thing that was really important was, just like every other group, we really liked the idea of walking around the green space here because it's a great trail. And now that you made mention of the, going to the Albacore, I think that's amazing. That's a great idea. The other thing we talked about was we really loved the idea of the parking garage down here. We also talked about the buildings being a little bit more, like we love the way that this building looks downtown versus the flat-topped buildings of the two new spaces that are right over here. We actually enjoy the way the buildings look. They don't look as, this is old, this is new. It's, they structurally kind of fit the, you know, what you see in Portsmouth, which is charming in character. And then we talked about Maplewood being a little bit more pedestrian-friendly. I actually walked down Maplewood quite a bit, but a lot of people commented that they felt like the traffic was too fast on Maplewood. So they talked about maybe widening the sidewalks and maybe narrowing some of the streets. So that was about it. But I think whatever you guys do is going to be pretty awesome. I do.
Number two, that the building height should slope down from toward the water. From the high point at Port Walk here, yeah, or somehow maintain the views through alternating the building heights so that it's possible to see through the buildings. Number three was a garage, and the people were in favor of a multimodal transportation center here, like has been mentioned before, with maybe in 20 years there might be an opportunity for a train there.
Yeah.
And find a way to connect Vaughn Street to the other side of Port Walk Place, which crosses over the railroad tracks, and which is a problem there, I guess, because of you need the air rights and whatever, but find a way to do that. And finally, everybody also like the emerald necklace around the point up here and all along the waterfront. And this lady here maintains the point out there and has done a really nice job of keeping it green. So.
This is table six here. We also, we seem to be in agreement with the walkway around here, and we'd like to see, the area of Cindy Ann and that, perhaps be areas of not such great buildings, but maybe break it down into restaurants or something perhaps in that area. But this area really dictates itself well. And we also thought that what we've lost a lot of on Maplewood Avenue is a voluntary greenway we've always had going all the way up to Congress Street. There are plantings, and it's been broken now by Port Walk. Although we have that planter, it's not. But the new buildings perhaps could give us a little more green. It wouldn't have to be huge trees, but something in, and that also would break the starkness of the taller buildings there. We also like the parking garage there, and our walkway, went behind the cemetery too and came down onto the mill pond, which, this land here is kind of invented anyway. I'm not really sure who owns it, and I think over here, when Joe Sawtelle built this, he actually wrote into his deed there that there was going to be a walkway going back this way, to that piece of land that. I'm probably forgetting something else. And we also mentioned perhaps a trolley car on the railroad track, but I didn't know if that was going to, if they would like that, since we have, am I forgetting anything?
Celebrating the art and historical aspect.
I guess we should leave. Yeah. Oh, we also, would like to talk about the historic you know, value of this area there, and it's something that a lot of people, I mean, this was a, just a, this was a mill building in the middle of that bridge that, you know, milled up ship timbers, and this was just all areas where there were a lot of ships being built back in the day, and it's something that we've never really emphasized there. Perhaps, you know, going in with, you know, up here with the albacore there, you know, that could be emphasized there, perhaps, and I think that's it there. Yeah, thank you.
Oriented here. This one's ours. Yeah. So let's see. I'm reading upside down. Sorry. So we wanted to take, I guess, Cindy Ann's Cleaners is over here. Yeah. And so the thought was, I think as other people have suggested, it would be a nice greenery area. Or, yeah. The idea would be to combine the green area around here as both a visual break, a tranquil break as you come in, to encourage people maybe to slow down, and also provide some green area by water for the community. A constant theme was increasing the greenery along any walking frontage. I think it's been mentioned many times here. It's obviously probably the most pressing need of all the needs, is so that when we're walking down the major ways that it's friendly, inviting, pedestrian scale. Another one was to protect the mill pond. I hadn't heard a lot of that about that before, was to actually protect it from you know, any extensive development. Another theme was for more affordable housing, smaller housing, and wherever it could be done, there were some interesting creative ideas thrown around about how to do that. One very interesting idea was to have a local transportation loop that ran continuously through major areas of not just downtown, but around Portsmouth, so that the more affordable land where you can actually build on a bigger scale is accessible, and have the loop run from early in the morning for people to come to work, and then again until late at night, you know, to encourage the people not to be driving home drunk. So I thought that was a very interesting idea. One of the other areas, which I think got a lot of positive feedback for affordable housing, was this area down here, Autumn Street, Hill Street, Pearl Street. And some ideas was, you know, not to change it drastically, but simply to provide more street improvements, paint, color schemes, other ideas that people might come up with. And they felt that it made a great community contribution in terms of affordable places for people to live. And again, the emphasis again was on walkable, friendly, greener major streets. Yeah.
So we're a group of six pretty poor listeners.
We missed the five big ideas completely. So I will try and summarize our thoughts, most of which echo a lot of what was said. Starting with the importance of taking as much advantage of that easement land as possible along the North Mill Pond. And we too had it kind of jagging in front of Maplewood here and then back through the cemetery and connecting back to the waterfront, the larger part of the North Mill Pond there. We spoke about the idea of preserving the character of this neighborhood down in here, where there's the kind of more low slung buildings and more moderate income housing, and then perhaps matching that maybe with different architectural style, but buildings that could also accommodate similar mixed use, similar moderate income housing in this area where behind the garage there, or proposed garage. We also, like I think a lot of the groups, wanted that connectivity between between Vaughn Street and this area of the north of the northern tier. You know, I had ridden in a pedestrian bridge. I don't know. There's got to be a way to solve that issue of getting from downtown into this area. And let's see. I think we also were mostly in agreement about the idea of this area being. Maybe we all didn't agree on the height issue, but we agreed that this was an area that that could be explored for more contemporary style architecture. That if there was a place in the city where we didn't need to conform to brick facades, that this might be a place where we want to do that. I think that's only four, but I'll stop there.
Thanks.
And just to recap what's already been said eight times. So there was a lot of discussion about how we have an increasing amount of apartments downtown, and so we feel that this area, we really need to be conscientious of the need for mixed use, in particular live-work, if we could explore opportunities for that kind of a situation in this neighborhood. And as it is a neighborhood and you know, should be able to be self-sustaining to some extent, included in that mixed use would be some kind of retail and services that support the people that live there. To be able to get the things that you need, useful stuff. Whole Foods is great, and that'll bring people for a certain reason, but you can't get everything you need there, and it'll probably leave most people wanting for a car to go somewhere else. So if we can maybe look at this as an opportunity to address those needs. Civic space, or space that's available to the public just for nothing. Just a place where you can sit and be a town common or town green kind of place. And maybe more than one, maybe lots of little pocket parks or, you know, just park benches on the street where people can be part of that flow and pooling of pedestrian flow. And then this could be a real opportunity to address some of the greater transportation issues that we've been talking about in the city. And it could be an influential opportunity. If we do it right here, it could maybe affect the rest of the town. Intermodal, multimodal, safe pedestrian access and connection to other parts of the town. Parking, of course. I'm sorry I brought up the P word, but you know, it's going to come up, and this might be an opportunity to be a little bit creative about how we store our cars and, you know, how we can maybe keep them out of the way and make more room for people. Maybe design with the people module, not the car module. and then, so I forgot to say that this is not necessarily in any particular order, and so maybe I saved the biggest one for last, or maybe it should have been first, but workforce housing. And you know, there's a lot of lip service to that, and there's a lot of misunderstanding about workforce housing and what it is and how you define it, but maybe I don't use the word workforce housing here. Maybe we just use affordable places for normal people to live. Just, you know, places that we can live. And that's all we have.